So now that we have our A-star in place, we can start spawning some enemies. So that's exactly what we're going to do in this video. We are going to add a next wave button, and we should be able to click that wave button just to spawn one random enemy. But in this video, we'll not make the enemies move or anything. We'll just add the possibility for us to spawn a random enemy at the start portal. So let's start with the button actually. So if we go to, let's see, our sprites and open up our UI, then you'll see that we have something called tower buttons. No, not tower buttons, menu buttons there. And this menu buttons has three buttons in it. Let's try to open it up here. Let's keep it at, sorry about that, I just misclicked. Keep it at 100 and click it as multiple. And sprite editor. As you can see, we have three different buttons here, and right now we are only going to use this little button, but later we are going to add the other buttons, or we can also do that now. But this is going to be our wave button. So click the slice button and slice, and then should divide them by itself. Then you should be able to click apply, and then you can close it down, because right now when you have done that, you will see that the menu button can expand. And we have three different buttons here. So you can take menu button 0 and drag it into the scene. And actually, no, we shouldn't do like that. We should go to our canvas here and right click and say UI and say button. And this is our wave button. So we can take the source image and we can switch it out with the menu button 0, like so. And then you click set native size. And then you'll see that it gets very large. But we'll have to scale that one down. So just press the button and find it in your scene and then hold down shift and then just scale it down. So it has like a fitting size, whatever size you want. I think mine is a little too big still. There, I guess. So I'm just gonna put it here in the middle. You can put it in the corners or wherever you want to, because the placement of the UI doesn't matter. So you can just put it wherever you want. I am going to make sure that it follows, it has the same distance between the top and the button, no matter what resolution. So I'm going to take the anchor here and click the top here. So this one moves up here. So it follows this point here. Okay. What else? The button has a text on it and we might as well set that up right away. So we can click on the text and here we can write next wave. And I would like to change the font, so I'm going to click on the little radio button here and select Carter 1. And the font size, I'm going to say 50 or something. And yeah, notice that the text disappears, that's totally fine. And then I'm going to say best fit. And I'm going to say that the color should be white. And then I'll click, there's an add component button here. Click add component, maybe you can't see it for the webcam. Add component, and I'm going to write shadow and click. Then we have a shadow on the text and you can just adjust this exactly as you want to. Try to move this up so you can see it. We have the shadow here. See what I've written down for the shadow on the text. Yeah, I have written down that it should be 2.65 and minus 1.98. I don't know. That's what I'm going with. Okay, so right now the text is going over the borders of the button. We're not interested in that, so we take our edges here and just move them in a little. When we have the text selected, move them into the, so they don't go over the green stuff on the button, like so. So now the text is actually more encapsulating the green area than the gray area, right? And also you can click on add component and write outline. And if you write outline, if I can spell correctly, there we go. Gonna move it up so you can see it. Here we have an outline. I'm also gonna keep that on the text. I think it looks better with the outline on it actually. And let's try to see how it looks when we maximize and play. There we go. Yeah, I think that looks totally fine. Could move the text a little maybe in the right side. Just to get a little more in. But yeah, you can always adjust it as you want to. So now we have our button and let's just call it next wave, so we know which button that does that thing. So this is our next wave button. The next thing we will have to do is to make sure that we can actually trigger something from that button, right? So we have to go to our game manager. So if we open up our scripts and go to game manager, and when the script is open, open on the wrong screen here, then we can create a new function, yeah, and that function should be spawning our what's it called, our waves. So inside the game manager we can say, let's see here, we can go to the bottom and not in A star, but in the game manager, go, give me a sec, I need to get control of all these tabs here, close all of this, and then game manager. Yes. Then we can go to the bottom of the game manager and we can wait, public void start wave. So this function will start a new wave for us, so that we can spawn our mobs. But this function itself will not spawn the waves, because we will have to do this basically in a coroutine, because we are going to do this little by little, so that when we spawn more mobs, we can spawn one mob and then it spawns and moves a little away, and then the next mob comes, instead of just spawning 10 mobs on the same spot and then they move on top of each other, so it looks like one mob but there's really 10, right? So to make sure that they spawn one by one, we'll make a coroutine so that they don't spawn on top of each other. But we can make a private IEnumerator, and that's what we do for coroutines, right? Called spawn wave. So this coroutine here will actually spawn a wave for us, so that we can actually spawn wave, so that we can actually spawn all our monsters. Yeah. So this is what we're going to do. It's going to spawn something. Start wave is called from our button. So if we save this and jump to Unity, and we click on the button, next wave button, then you'll see that there is a button component here, and this button component has an onClick function. So we can click on that to open up whatever should be executed when this onClick function is called, and then we can take our game manager and drag down here, click on the functions, go to game manager, and then we need to select that one called start wave. And right now I can't see it because I guess I didn't save my script. Okay, I have an error here. You can just out comment this, save without the error, and then click on functions, game manager, and start wave. So now this button here, whenever I play the game and I click this button here, well, then it is going to execute the function in here, this one, and this function up here should start this function that spawns a wave down here. So we can say start coroutine spawn wave. Just need to comment it back in again so I can see it. Spawn wave. Well, I'm doing very well here. Spawn wave, there we go. And of course I need to hit that. There we go. So now we start our spawn wave coroutine. And in the coroutine we need to return something. So I'm going to say yield return new wait for seconds 2.5. so this is the time delay whenever we start a spawn wave, it will take before we spawn the next monster or the next thing. So let's just yeah, keep it at 2.5. we can always change this later. What else do we need to do? We need to spawn a monster somehow. And how do we do that? Well, actually we are going to create an object pool at some point. I'll explain more about the object pool when we get to it. But the thing is, when our mobs is moving through, they're moving through the level, there's lots of towers and they're all firing projectiles as these mobs, right? And every time we a tower fires a projectile, you need to create a projectile, and that projectile needs to be created, and it needs to be destroyed when it hits the monster, and then it fires a new one that needs to be created and destroyed, right? So to make this more efficient, we will create an object pool which basically means whenever we are done using a game object, we will reuse it later. So let's say our lightning tower fires 10 bullets, right? Those 10 bullets hits a target. And instead of destroying those bullets, we just move them off screen or make them invisible. And then next time the lightning tower needs to fire, instead of creating a new bullet, it will just take one of those bullets and reuse it, right? And the same goes for our monsters. We will also put them into the object pool. So when the monsters have despawned and they're done, well, then we will reuse them for the next wave, for example, so we don't need to destroy them and create them again. So to do this, we need to create a new, what's called new script. So right click in your script folder and write object pool. And right now it's not going to have any real functionality. It would simply just create our monsters. But later it will actually have functionality in it. But for now, just delete start and update. So you have an object pool like this. And inside the object pool, we have to do one thing first of all. We have to create a private game object array, because we need somewhere to contain our prefabs, right? So this game object array will contain a prefab for every single monster in the game, because at some point, let's say we have spawned 10 monsters and the next wave needs 11 monsters. Well, we can reuse the 10 of the monsters, but if there are no more monsters to reuse, we need to grab them from an array and create one. So next time we can create 11, but number 12 will need to be recreated for the next time, and so on. So we always increase the object pool size so we can reuse whatever we just created. And to create something new when the object pool is empty and we don't have anything to reuse, it will need to create something new. So we can create an array called object prefabs. So this array will contain all the prefabs. So we can simply go back to Unity and create those prefabs. Let's just do that. Let's go to this sprites folder and the monsters and move. So right now I'm simply going to use one sprite for each monster, but of course we will animate them later and everything to make it more to make it look more like a real game. But let's just do like this. Let's take blue down here. Click on blue down. Select multiple sprites and say the pixels per unit is 300, or at least that's the scale I'm going with. And sprite editor, click slice and then click slice and apply this. And when you apply it, you'll see that inside blue there spawned a lot of files. Take blue 0, drag it into the scene. Then do the exact same thing for the rest of them. We have green down, make it 300, and make it to multiple sprites. Sprite editor, apply, and slice, apply, close, open green down, take the first one and pull it out. Do the exact same thing for purple down, select 300, multiple sprite editor, apply, and slice and apply. And then for the last one, just take purple down, pull it in, close this. Then for the last one, red down, open it up, select it, multiple sprites, 300, apply, sprite editor, slice and apply, and then pull the last one into the actual game here. Okay, now we have all these monsters here. So let's call these something. Let's call this one blue monster, green monster, purple monster, and red monster. So select all these and go to your prefab folder and maybe create a new one called monsters. And in that one, we can simply take all our monsters and drag them in. I guess we need to do it one at a time. Red, purple, green, blue. And delete all the prefabs from the scene. So now we have created all our prefabs and we can start spawning them. To spawn the monsters, we will have to go to our object pool, because the object pool needs a function that we can ask, so that we can ask the object pool for a new object whenever we need it. For example, let's say a tower needs to shoot a bullet, then it can ask the object pool to throw a bullet back at it so it can shoot it out in the game world. And the object pool will simply decide if it needs to create a new bullet or if it needs to reuse an old bullet that it already had. But that functionality is not there yet, but for now we will create the object pool so it can spawn monsters at least. So public game object get object. So it's a simple function that actually creates a new object and returns it. And it needs to take in a type, string type. Because whenever we ask the object pool to spawn an object, we will need to tell it what kind of object it needs to spawn. And then we can make a for loop. And it needs to run through every single prefab here, because when I ask the object pool for a red monster, for example, it needs to run through the prefabs to find the exact red monster so it can spawn, right? So objects prefab, object prefabs.length needs to run through the whole array. So if our object prefab position I, so the position we're looking at right now, dot name is equal to type, could also use it for each loop for this if you want to, then we will say game object new object is equal to instantiate object prefabs position I. There we go. And let's say new object dot name equals type, and then we simply return new object. And what else? Then we see return null. There we go. Because the function needs to return something in all stages, and if it doesn't return the proper object, well, then it's simply going to return null down here because we typed in a wrong name, for example. Okay, so in our game manager, we will need to make use of this. First of all, our game manager will actually need to have a reference to our object pool. So the easiest way to do this is to make a property and call it object pool and call it pool, and then we will simply put the object pool on the game manager game object. So the easiest way we can do this is just to make a private awake void awake, and then we can simply say object pool, what do you call it, pool equals get component object pool. There we go. So we created a property for accessing this pool, and we are going to make it into a property because then a tower can ask the game manager to go through the object pool to get that object, right? Instead of having every single tower accessing the object pool by itself, we'll simply just make it public inside the game manager. So the game manager is basically sharing the object pool to the rest of the game. And then it's going to get component object pool on itself, which means that we will have to go to the game manager and say add component and then write object pool. So now the game manager can just say get component because it's sitting on the same object. We could also just make it make another object and drag it onto the game manager and then go through there. If you want to do that, that's totally fine. I'm just doing like this because I think it's easier. Okay, so now we have our object pool, so we can use it now. So let's go to the function here and let's see, what do we want to do? We want to make a random monster. So we can say monster index equals random dot range, and we have four monsters, so it's between 0 and 4. There we go. And it doesn't include the upper bound as far as I'm concerned, so it's 0, 1, 2, 3. It can roll between inclusive and max bound inclusive. It says that max bound is inclusive, but I have tested this and I've never ever rolled the upper bound here, so I think the documentation here is actually wrong, that it says it also rolls 4. I'm like 99% sure that's wrong, but you can correct me if you actually managed to do so. String type is equal to string dot empty. Okay, so now we have a string. We need to set that string equal to the actual prefab we need to spawn based on the role. So we can make a switch case and say we switch on the monster index. So let's say case 0. So if we roll 0, then we set the type equal to blue monster. And then we break. So I just copy this one and paste it. 1, 2, 3. And then say case 1, case 2, case 3. And on case 1, we say red monster. On case 2, we say green monster. And on case 3, we say purple monster. Okay, so we are creating a random number between 0 and 3. We are looking at that random number, and depending on what random number we just rolled, we would like to spawn a blue monster, a red monster, a green monster, or a purple monster. So if we roll 3, then we are going to set the string type equal to green monster. And then we are going to say monster, let's create a monster first, pool.getObject. Get object type, because we just created our type up here, and our pool get object is asking for type. And then we say get component monster, and we need to create the monster script. So right now we don't have a monster, and actually we might wait with this for the next videos. We're running a little long, sorry about that. So pool.getObject will instantiate and return a game object to us, but we're not going to use the game object right now, so we'll wait with that for the next video. And yeah, if we save this now and we jump into Unity and play the game and click the next wave, we'll see if we get an exception. Let's see why we do that. Object prefabs.length is not set, so we haven't set our objects. So we need to stop this and open our object pool, and you can see we can't access the prefabs yet. So we need to go to this one and make this one into a serialized field. So we instantiate our objects and then go back here, wait for it to update, and say we need 4 objects, not 40, but 4. And then we take the blue monster in the first one, green monster in the next, purple in the third, and red monster in the last fourth one. Okay, so let's try one more time. Play the game. Next wave, we spawn a purple. Next purple, red, purple, purple, red, blue. See if we can spawn a green one. That was a green. And as you can see, now we can spawn lots of monsters by clicking this one. And it's not the ideal thing. You can see we have all these monsters here. It's not, but now we have the base of what we need to spawn a wave, right? Because we can spawn one monster. So I'm going to end the video here so it doesn't get too long. But in the next video, we will try to spawn them on top of the portal, which is their starting point, and then later we'll animate them and move them towards the red portal. So I hope that this was useful to you. So thank you very much for watching, and remember to like my Facebook page, follow me on Twitter, and subscribe to the channel. If you haven't done it already, please do so. Also, if you would like to support me, you can support me in different ways, because remember that Inkscape Studio is purely supported by the community, so it helps me out a lot when you support me. You can do that by clicking the link in the top of the screen to go to the Patreon page, where you can support me and get every single project that I've created, and all sprites and assets, and you can use them in as many projects as you want to, of course. Or you can click the bottom link just to get one of my projects as a standalone product. So, thank you very much for watching.